Greg Kasavin is here
yes.
with Transistor, the second game from Supergiant Games.
That's right.
You guys, of course, released Bastion a number of years ago now. And you've been working on this one for about 2 years, and it's out next week.
That's right.
All right,
indeed it is.
Let's hop straight into
it. Yeah, this is the very beginning of the game. This is essentially what we, and I will just rudely talk over.
Go for it.
The voiceover that you're hearing here, but yeah, we like to throw you in at the deep end of in our games and just get you playing as quickly as possible. And then because you got the whole game to figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. But what's going on is you play as this character called Red, who discovers this unusual weapon called the Transistor, and no sooner does she find it than these kind of bizarre forces appear and are desperate to recover the weapon by any means, basically take her out. Why that is happening, who wants her dead, what the significance of the Transistor is, that's all a big part of the story that you'll discover.
And the who wants her dead thing is actually kind of hints at this like vaguely noir vibe you guys have going here, which I've really appreciated in the time I've got to sort of check the game out. And it's kind of got, I feel like the like big impersonal city, it's a big shift from where you guys were in Bastion, but how's it been to like play around with that new setting, with that new tone?
Yeah, it's been a really, like for me, and I think pretty much all of us on the team, I think it's just been a really exciting part of this. I mean, after we finished Bastion, we really liked just making up our own world and setting and seeing that people actually enjoyed what we came up with. Mm-hmm. So having made this weird fantasy frontier game with Bastion, we wanted to see if we could come up with something again that, you know, just had our own take on it and had its own feel. So we wanted to, having done fantasy, we wanted to see what we'd come up with more in the science fiction direction. And we started with kind of the cyberpunk aesthetic, the kind of cityscape. We didn't want like laser guns and spaceships and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But then we kind of systematically rejected pretty much all of the conventions of cyberpunk. There's no like big fat magnums and, you know, flowing trench coats and brain implants and those kind of things.
We love all
that stuff, but it's been done so well by so many of the things that inspire us that like we wanted to just come up with our own angle on it. So in short, we ended up with this.
From the brief time I've played with it, I love all the storytelling in this first chapter, at least what I've played before, is really remarkable in terms of just like all the inconsequential sort of stuff, like being able to look through that. And the way in which, I associate a lot of these types of games with farming or just repetitive mode.
Right.
But the pacing of this, has that been a really important part?
It really is. We are like big on sort of non-fat game design, as it were, of like we want it, we really value efficiency of storytelling and basically just respecting the player's time. There's like a lot of, we want to make these kind of meaty games with really rich systems that you could sink your teeth into, but at the same time make the sort of thing where you value the time you spend with it. You feel like your time is being respected, like I said. So that means having a particular pace to it and having like sort of a frequency of interesting things happening per unit of time. And just, yeah, being able to take in the world of the game through all sorts of different sources. You have these kind of informational terminals here that are revealing, I think, little aspects of how this world works as you go on through.
And next time you get that Wii survey feature they have, Ask Me or something.
Inspired by the Ask Me service.
Can you just explain some of the combat mechanics that are happening here for folks who don't know?
Yeah, this is really at the heart of the game. The Transistor is this kind of all-powerful weapon, and one of the things it can do is stop the world and let you plan your next set of actions and then kind of execute them in a supercharged fashion. We wanted to combine kind of the pleasures of classic turn-based games and tactical RPGs with the immediacy of action RPGs. So you could play this game like an action RPG, press the buttons and hit stuff, and we wanted it to be really easy to pick up and play. But then we very early on introduced this kind of strategic planning mode where it really kind of makes you stop and consider your actions and really become, I think, invested in how you play. And we really wanted to get the kind of suspense out of it that we feel that a lot of classic games like that have, where you have that moment before you hit go on your turn where you're like kind of biting your nails in anticipation, wondering whether it's going to go spectacularly wrong or go just as you planned. We wanted to have that happen as part of the moment-to-moment play. So it's a really powerful ability, but you discover early on that it does have certain limitations. Like this particular enemy, you find that she will change position every time you hit her, so even though on some guys you could just kind of go to town on them, she is resistant to that, so you're going to have to find another way of dealing with her. And we want players to just be mindful of how they're fighting and use cover and use position and all that kind of stuff. Just be thinking about a lot of interesting things as they play.
And amazing how, like, this eerie character design and the sort of ominous floating and attacks can make the innocuous words young lady, you stick them together and all of a sudden it's really sinister.
Yeah, no, thank you. Yeah, we try to, again, from my point of view, it's all kind of part of the exposition is almost a bad word when it comes, people have a negative connotation with what that word means, but for me it's really like everything is exposition, so you're just learning about the world in every respect, even from the names of these things that you're fighting and every aspect of the interface and so on. So we try to use all of those different tools to give you a sense of what the world of this game is like.
I can hear somebody speaking there, obviously we're talking over it. Pitted the Great on Twitch asks, is there a cool narrator again? One of the most wonderful things about Bastion, unique aspects, was the narration throughout it. Have you guys done anything?
You can say that. It is not, it is, so every member of the team that worked on Bastion, including Logan Cunningham, who is the voice of the narrator, worked together again on Transistor. That was very much our goal, is just to stick together and make something new.
Excellent.
We don't have, in fact, the sword, the Transistor itself that Red is carrying around is speaking to her, and Logan Cunningham is voicing that character. It's not a narrator per se, it's not like an omniscient character with some foreknowledge of the events. He's in the world of the game, kind of experiencing the events of the story as they occur. So from my point of view as the writer, it's a very different kind of narrative mode, and required kind of a very different writing style. We think the character itself is rather different as well, but it was really wonderful to work with Logan. I think the world of Logan as an actor and just as a dude. So it was just great to get to work together again on a project.
Monkey Robot on GameSpot asked a question that I think is very interesting, especially considering your previous life as a games critic. What are the games / experiences that have influenced what Transistor has become?
Oh man, this is like
I opened up Pandora's box.
No, this is the hardest for me because in my mind it's all like it's such there are so many things. Like we were just playing Thief. Mm. Thief is an inspiration to me. I don't think you'll see any real evidence of Thief in this game, but like I was talking about how amazing like the world building is in Thief, and that to me is like a huge inspiration from a world building standpoint, for example. But then, you know, it's a lot of it's so many things because there are many games from a particular era, though. I think that like mid to late 90s era is really inspiring to us as a team. A lot of our favorite games come from that era, such as Thief or another game I mentioned earlier, Baldur's Gate. Mm. So that in that game, you could pause and issue orders. That wasn't really like a central part of the game, but that was the type of thing we were thinking about of like, hey, what if that could be extended to become, you know, less of like kind of an interface assist and more of like a central component of the play experience.
Do you feel like you could have gone on to games development if you hadn't been a critic before? Do you feel like that was an essential part of learning about what games are?
Well, so for me it was for sure, because I wanted to make games since I was a little kid, since I was like 8 years old. But I did not take to teaching myself to program particularly well.
This bit's pretty great.
Doesn't
he say something to you?
Yeah. This is our little Looney Tunes kind of moment of, these guys chase you out of the room, and you discover that these enemies you're fighting, they level up just as you do. So
sorry, but you were saying?
Oh, for sure, like, learning to think critically about games has been essential to whatever it is I've been able to do as a game developer. It's given me confidence in my convictions about just having a particular perspective on things, and that it can be really hard to make decisions when working on games, because you could design things in any number of ways, and just like having a sense of what, how you want something to feel, and having a knowing which things you think work well, which don't. I mean, I really value my past experience at just having been able to just play a lot of games and think about what worked about them, what didn't, not just, you know, going past the superficial of like, I thought that was awesome. Well, why?
Yeah.
What worked for you about that? Or what didn't work for you? What didn't you like? And sometimes you get these really interesting cases of, it's a game, you know, you didn't like it, but it had some really amazing idea in there that you thought maybe with a little more, with a little something else, maybe that idea could have been amazing. That kind of stuff I always valued as well.
There's a lot of people in both Twitch and GameSpot asking this question. I'm gonna throw it to NiceGuy7767. The soundtrack is amazing. Who did it?
That is the work of Mr. Darren Korb. And with our vocalist Ashley Barrett, it's they again. They're the Darren did the soundtrack for Bastion.
That's our way out.
Bastion's the first game Darren's ever worked on, okay. You know, I think he's
five blocks
well.
Down.
People will see for themselves how the music is once again a very big part of this game, and I think there's some really fantastic stuff on here. Darren is really remarkable at what he does, and just. An awesome dude. So it's really my pleasure to get to work with a guy like that, and we're really excited for the soundtrack for this game, how people are going to take it. Because
are you going to release it separately?
We have a standalone soundtrack release that'll be there on Tuesday, same as the game.
Do a vinyl version.
Some people have suggested that perhaps we should. It's something that the thought has crossed our mind. But like I said, we have no plans beyond the launch, so we shall see. So we're about to get into crazy uncharted territory here.
Okay.
We have never shown a minute past the end of this sequence.
I
didn't
fantastic.
Plan this far ahead.
I've seen this motorbike sequence so many
times.
Yeah.
Normally it ends
situations.
Here at PAX, but like, I'm not going to play too much farther. It's really important to us to not give away too much, but I will show you that there is, in fact.
Stop whenever you feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Every little bit.
Sneak peek.
We'll take it. Yeah.
Obviously, this is an earlier build as well. This isn't the retail or
version. This is pretty much it.
Oh, man. All right.
You arrive.
You can just leave this here. It's fine.
Red has decided to. The transistor suggested that maybe Red should get the hell out of town, and it seems Red has other ideas, so she's going.
Okay.
She's going somewhere. She's on a mission.
All right, a sneak peek. You'll have to wait another 7 days to see any more for yourself. What platforms is this out on? How much is it going to cost?
PlayStation 4 and PC via Steam. Coming, Tuesday next week for $20.
Awesome. So. What are you going to do then on launch day? What does that involve?
Well, first thing I'm going to do is just panic.
Okay.
I'm just going to be looking at reactions to the game.
Yeah.
I am very, very interested to see what people think of it. So I think that is mostly what I'm going to be doing, just trying to absorb all the impressions out there.
Were you ever a don't read the comments guy when it came to reviews or anything, any content you did here at GameSpot?
I don't like comments on reviews. I don't mind them as much as many people on other things.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are actually some really funny. I think comments have almost a bad reputation sometimes. That there's some really amazingly funny stuff that happens in comments spontaneously on occasion, and then there's the other stuff. But yes,
you get a good filter going. And then
No, but there are certain message boards and things that shall not be named necessarily that I happen to. Keep a close watch on. Folks there, it's like they're unfiltered. They're just saying what they think.
Yes.
Even if you know their minds are filled with horrible, hateful things, there are sometimes kernels of truth in some of those things. And I like to see what the impressions are one way or another, because those are the people who, you know, ultimately these are people who have like taken the time to say something about this game, if not to buy it, and so on. And we respect that, we value that. That's the reason we're still around.
And then similarly, on the other side, will you be reading reviews?
Oh, yeah. Will
is that
I?
Weird for you?
No, it's okay. I used to get asked, like when I first went into development, like some of the guys I worked with were like, is it, they asked the same question.
Yeah.
I'm like, I think I'm the best equipped to handle this than most of you. Like for me, it's like, developers know what they're putting out there, I think, ultimately.
Right, yeah, like in their heart of hearts.
Yeah, and our philosophy is like you can't argue with someone's experience with the game. If they like it or if they don't like it, like you can't go, no man, you weren't playing it right. You didn't play it on the right difficulty or whatever. That's the game's fault that it didn't, you know, live up to whatever that player was expecting. The game fell short for that person, and you gotta just take it and find whatever truth is in there and see if you care about that for your next go around. So we value all that stuff, and yeah, we're kind of waiting on pins and needles to. At the same time, you know, we have no. From a certain point of view, we for sure don't know what people are going to say exactly, because, like I said, you know, we've only ever shown a tiny portion of this game. We've got a whole big game behind those first 20 minutes or so. So yeah, we shall see.
You haven't got much longer to wait. Greg Sabin, thank you so much for coming
pleasure.
On.
Thank you.
And hanging out with us and playing Thief as well. Much appreciated.